ओके, सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विथ टाइम मैनेजमेंट। व्हाट इज टाइम मैनेजमेंट इज बेसिकली व्हाट इज अंडरस्टूड आउट ऑफ रियल प्रोजेक्ट मैनेजमेंट स्टफ ड्यूरिंग द एजुकेशन स्टडीज। इन जनरल व्हाट पीपल अंडरस्टैंड प्रोजेक्ट मैनेजमेंट इज एक्चुअली अ टाइम मैनेजमेंट, प्रोजेक्ट टाइम मैनेजमेंट ओनली। So normally if you go to the people and ask what is project management, they will tell you about PERT CPM. That is how to schedule and how to take care of critical path. Okay, that is what is understood as project management, and that is nothing, just time management. Project time management is about preparing a schedule and maintaining it. What is the purpose? The purpose is to ensure that project deliver within time. The purpose of the time management is to deliver the outcome of the project in the stated time or in the estimated time. And this part is normally considered as project management outside of standard project management domain as such. If you go in many institute, universities, colleges, even in the industry who are not practicing project management, they think that project management is PERT CPM. Okay, so here we will understand how we can develop a schedule and how we can maintain it. Basically, if you prepare a Microsoft project plan or project plan or project schedule in Primavera, Microsoft Project, or any other scheduler, time management is actually the principles behind those tools and the methodology used in these tools or your scheduling concepts. So you implement the scheduling in Microsoft Project, Primavera, or other scheduling tools, but here this is what the concepts run behind that. So there are 7 activities in this. They go like this. 6 out of them are planning and 1 is controlling. So you can understand the gravity of the planning or the really importance of the planning. You see, you can see that it is so many processes are in planning. Okay, this is the overall process. The plan schedule management, prepare a schedule management plan, that how you are going to develop the schedule, what is the methodology you are going to use, what are the tools you are going to use for that, once you, and what are the your measure of units, how you are going to track it, all these things about taking the how we going to the prepare or manage the schedule is written in the schedule management plan. The first activity in preparing the schedule is the defining the activities. How you define the activities? You already have a work breakdown structure. You have work package. Work package is the smallest deliverable which is to be produced. And define activity means for every work package, we need to identify activities which are to be performed to produce that work package. So that means we will take work breakdown structure WBS as an input. We will look at the work package. For every work package, we will identify the activities to perform to produce that specific work package. Okay. Then the next step is to sequence those activities. So once you identify the activities, you define the relationship among them by sequencing them. Which will happen first, which will happen later, who is the successor of what, and who is the predecessor of what. Once you do these two things, the third thing is to estimate the resources. For every activity, you estimate what type of resources are required, what type of skills we need, and how many quantities, or how many quantities are available. You may be requiring 10, but only 2 are available, so you need to work with 2. Now based on this, you estimate the duration of the activity. How long this each and every activity we have identified here, will take. We put all these things together, that will be called project schedule. And once we do produce the project schedule, we do some optimization techniques. PERT CPM is one of the technique to look at the critical path and see that how we can shrink it or how we can expand it depending upon what is our timeline. And then optimizing the overall schedule, the resource utilizations, and trying to achieve with the minimum delay. Okay, and then the control schedule means doing all these activities again and again for the changed scenario. So every time you something happens in the project, some progress happen, things do not go as per the plan or some changes happen, because of that you may need to resequence the activities, you may need to change your resources, you may need to change your duration, you may need to optimize the schedule once again, and that is called schedule control. So first is the schedule management plan, and schedule management plan is basically is all about project schedule, preparing a model, what type of level of accuracy we need from the schedule, what is the unit of measure we're going to measure in days, in hours, in weeks, in years, in months. Okay, what kind of tools and techniques we're going to use, Microsoft Project, we're going to use Primavera, we're going to use some other Claret, HP Quality Central, or any other tool which we which our organization authorize or allow us to use. What are our control threshold? That 5% is our control threshold. Anything go beyond 5%, our schedule is delaying more than 5%, that means we need to take action. How are we going to measure the performance? What are the reporting format to provide a status of the schedule status to the people? Right, all these things are part of the schedule management plan. The first thing in the process is the define activities. How are we going to define the activities? Like you take an example, take an example of software. We need to develop as a financial product, we need to develop a cash flow module. So that is the work package. What is this? This is a work package. Now to produce this work package, I need to write a specification, I need to do coding, I need to do unit testing, I need to get my code reviewed, and based on the problems find in this and this, I need to do some kind of rework on my coding, and once I do this, my development is complete and I have produced the cash flow module. Now the next step will be to integrate them. That could be outside of this module's work, right? This is how we identify the activities for each and every module, each and every work package. Okay, you see the scope baseline, basically your work breakdown structure is then input here. Okay, decomposition, I don't see this terminology is right. My opinion is decomposition means dividing into, but here we are not dividing anything, we are identifying, we are listing. So decomposition is a misnomer here, is not a right word. I think identification of the activities would be the right word here. What we get is the list of activities, this activity attributes means when this will start, who will work on it, whose predecessor is this, whose successor is this, right? We can have a milestone like development completed could be a milestone, right? So we get activity list, activity attributes which define the activities, and milestone. Rolling with planning, I actually explained you that if I have a 6 month long project, in the beginning I do not know much about project, so I define a 1 month window to detail out my activities. So in one first 1 month I detail our activities in here in details and here in broader term. When I move 15 days in this, I move the window ahead. Whatever come in between this, I put out details, detail planning. So because I know more and more about the project as I move, I am better positioned to detail out in the next window. This window can get bigger and bigger as you move into the project, as you get to know more and more about the project. The whole idea is that there is no need that we should complete our schedule to a minute level in the beginning itself. We can progressively elaborate it, and then maybe in a 6 month project, after 3 months or after 2 months, I have a better schedule than on the first day. Right? This is the idea. We get activity list, activity attributes. What are the attributes? Activity ID, WBS ID, which WBS it is attached, name, description, which is the predecessor, which one is the successor, leads and lags, who's the resource working on it, when it's going to start, when going to end, is there any constraint on it, something like that. And we also get a list of milestones. We also define a list of milestones, what we are achieving in this. That could be a little extended list of the milestone plan we produce in, or we provided as a guidelines in the charter. The next thing in this is a sequencing activities. So in the sequencing activities, what we do, we produce a network diagram which basically defines what activity will happen after what activity, which activity will happen later, which activity will happen earlier, what are the dependency among them. And normally we use PDM, precedence diagramming method. There was also one method called ADM, that is arrow diagramming method, but now this is obsolete, so only one is used. Okay, then we do some leads and lag and produce a network diagram. Okay, so network diagram means something like that, something like this. So it is a PDM method. Okay, why it is a PDM method? PDM method means the activity is on node and dependencies by arrow. In the activity on node, it is also called AON method. And with this we try to identify the critical path. Now we cannot know right now until unless we understand the durations. Until we estimate the duration, we cannot get critical path. So critical path we get only once we have identified dependencies, put up a network diagram, and also know the duration of each activity. This is quite familiar thing, right? Many people have already learned about it. But just let me tell you, there are, when we define dependencies like this, there are four type of dependencies. The four type is, one is sequence, B depend upon A. So this is B, this is A. So B depends upon A. When A will finish, B will start. Okay, or B can start as soon as A finishes. Second is start to start. That means as soon as A start, B can also start. B cannot start earlier, but we can start little later. If you want, you can start B from here like this. That is okay, but it cannot start from here. Similarly, it is finish to finish means as soon as predecessor finishes, successor can finish. So successor can finish here as well. In the picture it is shown here, so that is possible, but the best thing will be when they finish at the same time. But the situation may be where you may need to end the successor later. But that is finish to finish means they can finish together, or the successor can finish little later. The fourth is a start to finish. That means the predecessor has to successor has to start before the predecessor finishes. A weird kind of dependency. I haven't seen it being used anywhere. So I normally discuss only these three. You got it? This is A and B both together. Here also A and B both together. But they can finish at the same time. They can finish at the same time. This can also be depicted as this. A, this is B, and this is C. So A and B, B and C are in parallel. Right? Most of the time you will see that these two things come in parallel, but sometimes there is something in the B happening here in the beginning which will cause the C to start. It's just not depending upon A. Similarly here. In that case, we will define start to start. Otherwise, we will work with finish to start most of the time, called FS. Is this clear? Along with this, we also have leads and lags. This is called lead. This is called lag. What is lag? Anybody has an idea what is lag? What is lags and leads? Difference between start and finish of an activity, that's the duration. That's the duration of the activity. You see, this is lag, and this is lead. Right, exactly. So this is lead. So you see, this is the dependency, right? This supposed to start from here, but it's starting here. Suppose it is 2 days. So I will say there is a 2 days lag. Right? A simple example is that you have built the pillars, but you cannot start the work of roofing the next day because the pillars will take some time to settle down. The cement in the pillars will take some time to settle down. Suppose they 3, 4, 5 days. You will start the roof only after 5 days. So it is normally called idle wait time. Idle wait time. Because you cannot do anything else but to wait for that activity to happen which is beyond your control. Like another thing is that there is a site A and there is a side B. So you have a half finished product here. Okay, half finished product here, which will go here to finish completely. Correct? And it will take, suppose, 5 days to transport this half finished good from here to here. So it is beyond your control, right? Now B can start as soon as half finished product is produced by at A, but still there is a 5 days lag. Because it will take 5 days to transport and project people have no control over it. The opposite to this is lead. That is the dependency is not over, but we have started the successor. The predecessor is not over, but successor is started. And we, this is very common. You know, our requirements are not complete. Before that, we start our design. We have not got the approval on the design yet, but we start working on some portion of the development or the construction. Because we know that in the design, even if some changes will happen, we are still good. This some specific things are not going to change anymore, right? In this anticipation, we make some lead, but this is always a risky venture. There is a possibility of risk here that the things which you have assumed are not going to change may change. In that case, you may be spending more time or more efforts. With this, we also have mandatory dependency and discretionary dependencies. What are the mandatory dependencies? That roof work can only happen after the pillars. You cannot change it. But there are four pillars. I can do these four pillars are independent. I can do these pillars one by one or together. That is at my discretion. So these discretion dependencies are very useful, called soft logic, and they are especially useful to optimize the schedule. We will come to this little later. Right? Now let's say sequencing activities. We have got a network diagram. And once you put lead and lag, the network diagram looks like this. So what is this? E depends upon B. So E can start as soon as B starts, but with a 1 day lag. So if B is starting on 8th day, E will start on 9th day. Similarly here, this is FS minus 2. The day F will finish, G starts 2 days before that. So if F is finishing on 42nd day, G will start on 40th day. It will finish on 42nd day, but 2 days before it will start. Similarly here, B finishes on 14th, then it will start on 19th. Right? This is how it is. So this network diagram will look like that. Now the next activity is to identify the resources for each activity. So next action is, we have all our activities, resource calendars means whether resources are available, risk register, because risk will also will be important for identifying the number of people for that or people actually for that. And then we use any of them for our assessment of resources required for activities. So what we come out with the resources requirement for each activity in the project. Probably resource work breakdown structure also, a hierarchical relationship among the resources. Right. So what is here is you look for the alternative analysis. Why we need alternative analysis? You estimate a particular number of resources. Suppose 5 resources for specific skills. Let's say draftmen. 5 people as draftmen, but only 3 are available. What do you do? You will do alternative analysis. What are the other ways of doing the things? Can we get little less capability person of draftmen who will learn from draftmen and do the job? What are the repercussion of that? Can we ask little more mature person to take up the high end work in the draftmanship? Or we need to work with only 3 people? So we need to find alternative so that we can figure it out what other type of skills we need and how many. Published estimated data is also helpful. So lot of companies, especially consulting companies, keep doing research and keep publishing their data. and that research or that data will help us to identify what type of resources we need on a particular activities where we have little less knowledge, right? Bottom up estimates means you estimate at the bottom in the hierarchy for each and every activity, then sum up at the work package level, and then sum up further and further to the end. That then we come to know about in the project what type of resources and how many numbers from when to when are required on the project. That will help us, that will help us to get that. This bottom up estimate will help us to get the complete picture of the resources at the project level. Project management softwares are often needed for such kind of activities. Whenever you are involved in schedule, normally doing scheduling without a software project or without a scheduler is normally difficult. What is the output? We now know how many resources or what skills are required from when to when for each activity. Now once you know the resources, okay, one more thing, RBS, you know that project manager, then there are two people report to him, maybe one is architect, another is team lead or super or engineers, or under engineers there are supervisors. So this relationship will call resource work breakdown structure. We can prepare it up to the when we include all the team members in our structure. Now we have all these things, we have to develop, because we know how many resources are available of what skills in what quantity, we can now estimate the duration of each activity. Right, we know this is the activity A. We have three people available who are draftmen. With these draftmen, how much time it will take to complete this work? I say it is 3 days. So this is kind of thing which we need to do here, and there are so many inputs are here because they all are influencing these factors. So what is here? We use analogous estimate, we use parametric estimate, 3-point estimate, and do some reserve analysis and decision making. The idea is to get the duration estimate of for each and every activity. What is an analogous estimate? I was having a project in past which is completed. Now I am doing another project which is very similar to this. So actual of this become estimate for this, right? It is one to one mapping. Analogous estimate is always one to one mapping. I am doing a project P1, I have a precedence of P0 which is very similar to P1, therefore I can use how I performed on P0 to estimate P1. This is one to one estimating. Okay, historical information about a project mapping to the new project which is similar to. How much accurate these estimates are? These estimates are as accurate as they are similar. More the similarity between P0 and P1, better will be the estimate here, right? So if there are less similarity, the less accurate estimates will be there. Another type of estimates also depend upon historical information is a parametric estimate, but parametric estimates are mainly formula driven like this. Days required to erect a wall is equal to wall length into productivity of one labor into number of labors. Number of labor I know, I have estimated in resource estimation. I know length of the wall. What I need to know? is this. Now this I don't know, and there is no formula to know, and therefore we do a regression analysis of past projects. It is not one-to-one mapping. Regression analysis goes like this. We map X and Y. Let's say here it is size and here is effort. Right? Now as size increases, we get or several, suppose we I have 100 projects executed in past. So I in every project I see how it mapped to efforts. What was the size of project and how the what is the size of the project and how they are how much efforts I spend. Now this is I have mapped all the 100. So some will come weird, very they are not the project which have gone very well, but in general if you see as the size increasing, the effort increases exponential. It is not straight. The line is not coming like this. The line is coming like this, right? Something like that. As the project size increases, the effort increases like this. So it will not be X is equal to 2Y or Y. It will be X is equal to 1 plus Y square plus Y. Some equation like that will come, which will show me that as the X increases, the Y increases more than the X increasing. Right? Depending upon that, I check that what is the productivity of my labor. Looked at this, all the scenarios. So I do a regression analysis and try to figure it out. What is the productivity of my labor, so of my people? So in all the organizations, normally big organization often publish their baseline data, which shows that our people's productivity is this. So that is normally based on regression, and therefore it depends upon past experience. I put that also get the value. So it is a mixture of formula and analysis of the past project. The difference between analogous and parametric is that analogous is one-to-one. It is about similarity in the projects. Parametric does not require any similarity. It is too many projects here. Then I come out with this some kind of formula, and then I apply this formula to predict the or to estimate the project, new project. That is P1. So here there are P1 to 100, and here it is P101 project. So I use previous 100 projects analysis to come out with a formula which will be applied to estimate 101 project. Make sense? And that is the difference between the analogous and parametric. The third type of estimates are PERT estimate. PERT estimate, see if you, the very common estimates are the estimates we call it expert judgment. You know, expert judgment. By expert judgment, we give or WBS estimate. We also call it WBS estimates. Why WBS estimate? We prepare a work breakdown structure and give it to some expert to put some magic figures there based on his understanding. Magic figure we say because there is no logic some many times, but expert says it is my understanding, it is how my experience says that the things have gone, and therefore I have estimated this much. The problem with the WBS estimate is that if you give these estimate to 10 people, the all 10 people will come out with the different estimates. To nullify that effect, the bias, nullify that, or to reduce this bias, not nullify, but to reduce this bias. To reduce this bias, we use POT estimates, and POT estimates are also called weighted average estimate, or weighted estimate, weighted average estimates. What we do in this, we ask expert not to put one magic figure, but to give three estimates. Most likely, that is the most common scenario, what is the time you think it will take? That is his magic figure. Then it says optimistic, means you think that ki nothing wrong will go. Whatever you thought of wrong about this activity, if nothing goes wrong, how much time you will take? So suppose you estimated 10 days here. You say if everything goes fine, no problems come, I will complete this in 8 days. Then you ask him the third estimate, you say, also give me pessimistic estimate. Means whatever you thought of can go wrong in this particular activity, you think that it has gone wrong. Now tell me how much more time it takes. And you estimated 15 days. That if everything goes wrong, it may take 15 days. If nothing goes wrong, it will be 8 days. If in a normal circumstance, it should complete in 10 days. And then I apply this formula, that is the optimistic, that is the 8, plus 4 into most likely, that is 4 into 10, plus pessimistic, that is 15, divided by 6. So how much is that? Let me see. Okay. So this is how we need to work out this. Now what help this? Suppose it is 10.5. Now another thing which we figure it out is the standard deviation. That is 15 minus 8 divided by 6. So 7 by 6. That is 1.2 something around, right? So standard deviation I get 1.2. So how much this activity will take? Is the activity will take 10.5 plus minus 1.2. That means it will take somewhat between 9.3 to 11.7. So the activity will somewhat finish between 9.3 to 11.7. If it is days, then 9.3 days to 11.7 days. You got it? We got a range in this. And this provide giving a range instead of a one figure is much more comfortable. Right? All understood? Will you like to do some exercise? Let's do this. So next 5 minutes for you. The one thing, let me explain you why we are creating variance here. If there are three activities A, B and C. Here it is 10.5, here it is 5.6, here it is say 8.2. Here that standard deviation is 1, here standard deviation 2, here standard deviation 1.5. Okay, now you can add this, but you cannot add standard deviation. You need to take a square, you can have to make a variance. The square of this, this is 1, then 4, then this, so it becomes 2.25, right? Then add them, so 4 plus 1, 5 plus 2, 7.25. And then, because this is variance, I have to take a under root of it. That is the square root of it. So a square root of this will come out to be somewhat 2 point something, right? 2.5 or 2.6, whatever it is. Correct, whatever it is. So we have to, if they are multiple, we cannot add the standard deviation. We have to make, we have to calculate their variance and then sum them up and then take the square root to get the standard deviation of the complete project. So similarly here in this exercise, standard deviation you can calculate for every activity, then you cannot sum this up. This was not possible. You have to create variance, sum the variance and then take the square root to get this value. Make sense? Okay, so next couple of minutes are for you to calculate and then we will move ahead. Okay? Got it? So the next step is this, like you do like a kind of this reserve analysis. Now reserve analysis is required to have some reserves in the project so that we can manage our timeline in case of any eventuality or any risk materializes. So we do that, how much buffers we need in a project, and then distributing that buffer properly is what the reserve analysis is to the calculating how much buffers we need, how much extra time we need to meet the project on time. That is what the reserve analysis is all about. So any contingency happens, then we should be able to address that properly without delaying the project. So what you get is the duration estimate for each activity, the range in which they can finish, the project duration, and what is the possibility of completing the project within a specific time, right? And then we put this thing together to develop the schedule. So if you see, schedule is the most centralized artifact on the project and most changing artifact on the project, because it depends on everything. If you see everything here in the project, all aspects of projects are impacting the project schedule. And when you move in the project, something here or there keep changing, and therefore your schedule changes. So the most changing artifact is the schedule. We use various techniques to optimize the schedule and keep the schedule on the track and seeing that we are delivering our project on time and keep optimizing the schedule. So with some of them are these, we call them schedule network analysis techniques, critical path method, critical chain method, resource optimization, modeling techniques, leads and lags, and schedule compression techniques. Okay, so we come over here and see one by one these activities. The first activity is critical path method, to calculate the critical path. How do we do you know how we calculate critical path? How do we calculate critical path method of like calculating the critical path? So what do we do? How we calculate? We take the total of realistic duration. What is realistic duration? We have already calculated the durations. Realistic duration and duty. So there is nothing called realistic duration. We have calculated the duration of all the activities. We need to identify the critical path now. How do we identify critical path? What is the method? Okay, let's say total of duration, the longest duration path, right? The longest duration. So, but if there are multiple, many branches in the project, the project is big, how long you will calculate the longest duration? You go through every path and try to calculate the longest duration. Don't you think it will take too much of time? Which activity is critical? What is the definition of critical? Why it is critical path? Why it is called critical path? What is the definition of critical? Yeah, but why it is important? It is important because any activity on the critical path, if get delayed, it will delay the project, not on any other path. How we calculate? We calculate the float on each activity. What is a float? Float is a time by which activity can be delayed without delaying the project. So if there is an activity A, if I delay it by 2 days and my project doesn't delay because of that, then I can say activity A has 2 days of float. Right? If I can delay activity A by 5 days without delaying the project ended, then activity A have 5 days of float. There are three type of float. We call total float, free float and project float. So the definition I just told you is the definition of total float. Free float means if I delay an activity, if I delay activity by 2 days without delaying the next activity, without delaying the successor, then it has a free float of 2 days. Okay, and project float means a free time available at the end of the project. So normally we talk about this total float in normal cases. Float means total float. What is critical path? Critical path means activities on the critical path have zero float. Zero float means if activity is delayed, then it will delay the project. Therefore, this activity is critical and float is zero. And there is the path which goes through zero float activities is critical path. We need to identify in our network diagram which activities have zero float, then draw a path through these activities and we will find that we have got a critical path. There is something called near critical path, where the float is very less, 1 day, 2 days. On one activity the float is 2 days, another activity the float is 10 days. I will say the activity with a float of 2 days is on near critical path, means on this path, if it is any activity get delayed by 2 days, that will become critical. Here it will not happen that way. So we not only have to closely monitor the critical path, but also monitor near critical path. Let's take an example. Look at this. I tell you the legends. EF stand for early start. EF stand for early finish. Late start, late finish. This is the name of the, in the middle you will find the name of the activity. Left is the duration and right is the float. So this is for this, D is the name of the activity. This is duration, this is float. We need to calculate. We need to calculate early start, early finish, late start, late finish. So how we calculate? We do a forward pass, then we'll do a backward pass. When we do a forward pass, we fill these activities, these things. And when we do a backward pass, we fill late start and late finish. Okay, let's do this. So this is starting on 0, right? 0 plus 3 will become 3. Right? It will start on 3 and will finish on 12, right? Similarly here, if you see, this is starting 0, this is starting, this is ending on 6, correct? Now here we have a contest, 6 and 3. B depend upon 6, A and D both. So which I will take? The larger one. When I am doing a forward pass, I will take a bigger figure. When I do a backward pass, I do a lower figure. The smaller figure. So here it is 3, here it is 6, I will take 6. It will start on 6. Then plus 7. How much become? It becomes 13, right? Now here also we have a contest between 12 and 13. So I will take 13 here, right? Then 13 plus 6, 19. Then it will start on 19. And it will finish on 26, correct? It will start on 26 and this will end on 33, right? Correct? Now similarly here, it depends, C depend upon B, so it will start on 13 and then finish on 24, correct? Right? Just let me know if I am making any mistake anywhere. Now, the total duration, how much total, what is the larger figure? 33. That will become the project duration. Now, but we have to find the critical path as well. We have found the duration of the project, but not the critical path. Let's do a backward pass. So, it will end on 33. Therefore, it will start on 26. Right? This will end on 26, so therefore this will end on, this will start on 19. Now come here, it is 19 and therefore here it is 13, right? It is the same figure because it all coming up. Now here it is contest, so here let's come over here, it is 33. And 33 minus 11 become 22, right? Now here it is a contest between 13 and 22. So I will take the smaller figure, that is 13. And minus 7 become 6. And here it is 6. And here it is 0, correct? Here it is 13, right? So put 13, then 3 here. Here again it is a contest, so 3 and 6, so I will take the smaller figure, they call 3 and make it 0, right? This is 4, right. This is 4. This is 4 actually. This is 4. Let me write here. This is 4. And therefore, this is also 4. This is also 4. Okay, so it's not 3. Right. Okay, so now what, how do you calculate float? The difference between this and this, the difference between early finish and late finish, or early start and late start, is called float. So this minus this is float. So I have float here 1. This minus this, the float here is 1. Here it is 0. Here it is 0, correct? On F again it is 0, on G again it is 0, on H again it is 0, and on C it will be 9, right? Correct? So which is the critical path? I match the, I go through the activities which have zero float and I get, so I will go from here, this is the critical path. Got it? Easy. This is near critical path. This is near critical path because float is only 1. Then we do a critical chain. Critical chain is all about identifying a critical path, then applying. Here we didn't take care of any resource issues. Okay, resource constraint we are not applying here. We don't consider resources. But in critical chain, we define the, we also consider the resource constraints. So resource constraint critical path is critical chain. So we, after applying resource constraint and then calculating the critical path, will become critical chain. Now what about the, how it will manage? We keep some buffers and we distribute these buffer at an important place, that is important milestones, and at the end of the project. So at the important milestone, at the end of the project. So what happens? The milestone should be delivered on time as well as the end project. And critical chain is all about buffer management, that how much buffer is left. So at the beginning of the project, I was having 10 days of buffer. I have utilized 2 days here, 1 day here, 3 days here. As of now, at this stage, if I am there, then I have a 4 days buffer still available, and I check if rest of the project this much buffer is sufficient or not. So it's all about buffer management. Everywhere I keep checking that how much buffer is left. A very good example of buffer management is a train system. You might have seen a train runs for long distance, say 24 hours, going from Mumbai to Delhi. Let's say normally it takes 18 hours or 17 hours. you will see that they are major stations. And many times you might have observed the team train reaches earlier than expected and stand there on the station for half an hour, for 15 minutes. Or it is standing just before the station for 15-20 minutes. What happens in this 18 hours, actually the journey time is only 16 hours. The 2 hours are actually buffers, which are put on every major station. They put half an hour buffer to manage. If train is reaching on, train is traveling on time, then it reaches earlier, stand on the station or before station. If it is running late, so here if you see, even train is running 1.5 hour late, 1.5 hour late till this place, it will still reach here on time. Because that much buffer it has. And you might have seen that when you went to sleep, it was running 2 hours late, but it reaches on the destination on time. Is the train running so fast? No. It just cover up through buffers. So you are satisfied. You feel good because the train reaches on time. So same thing you need to do for customer. Customer feel good. You give him the time where you can deliver, including the buffers, so that customer feel good about that you have delivered on time instead of delaying the things. There are resource labeling. So resource labeling come like this. This is 8 hours for every resource. But some resources can go over allocated, go above the 8 hours. You allocate them more. So this boundary, this upper bar looks like this, will become like this. Okay. So there's a bulge get created, which is an over allocation bulge. Means the person who's supposed to allocate only 8 hours has got 12 hours allocation, 10 hours allocation, 9 hours allocation. Here 16 hours allocation, or something like that. Now the person has only 8 hours. He cannot complete for 12 hours. He cannot complete for 16 hours, he cannot complete for 9 hours. Therefore, you may be predicting the project will finish on this date, it will not finish on that date. Because of this much extra time which is distributed. So, to predict the right, to estimate the right end date of the project, we need to remove this bulge, remove this over allocation. And when we push it down, what will happen, where this bulge will go? It will go in this direction. The project get extended. So your realistic date is not this, realistic date is actually this. If you commit this with this much of over allocation, you will actually complete here, making your customer dissatisfied. So resource labeling is very, very important. We must label the resource before we baseline the project. We remove the over allocation and see the realistic figure and see by when we will be able to finish it, and then committing the dates. Resource smoothing is something like not allowing this to happen. As soon as you see over allocation, you adjust the task. This can automatically can happen in the MS project. If you make it automated, as soon as your over allocation happen, it keep changing the task scheduling so that it doesn't allow any resource over allocation. There is something called simulation, we call modeling techniques, and simulation, when simulation comes, then Monte Carlo automatically comes. Very famous. Simulation is a way of scheduling in multiple ways, end to end. So you instead of developing one schedule with different permutation combination, you prepare 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 schedule and then see every schedule and analyze it and then see which schedule I should follow. This is called simulation. In simulation, you discover many risks, many issues, plus your probability of completing the project on a specific date. So if out of 5 schedule, 3 schedule are finishing on near to one specific date, you can say the chances we will complete the project on this date are more. In a specific cost, if more simulations are coming near to a particular cost, that means that is a more realistic one. The probability of any activity being on critical path. So suppose one activity is on critical on all 5 simulations. That means his criticality index is high. And if any activity is on critical only on 2 simulations, not on other 3, that means his criticality index is low. So the activity which is critical in all the simulations, then means it is highly critical and has to complete on time to deliver the project on time, right? And that is what we come to know through simulations. Simulation and Monte Carlo are more or less synonyms. Leads and lags we have understood already. Leads and lags help us to achieve realistic project end date. If we do not apply leads and lag, we may commit early or late. When we have to, suppose we are looking for project for 6 months, but when you schedule it goes for 6-7 months, we need to compress it to 6 months, but only that much which is possible. Do not unrealistically compress it. So two activities come into picture, two methods, one is crashing, another is fast tracking. What is crashing? Crashing is adding resources and getting the duration of the task shorter. And fast tracking means two activities which are happening in sequence now change to happening in parallel, taking on lead or completely in parallel. Here the discretionary dependency I was talking about come into picture. Because this can only happen in discretionary dependency. 4 pillars, pillar 1, pillar 2, pillar 3 and pillar 4 are in sequence. But I can say, oh, let me take one more person and do 2 pillars at one time. So I will reduce the duration by half. Suppose it was taking 4 days, now it will take 2 days. That is called fast tracking. Whenever I do this, normally my risk increases because I compromise the reasons for keeping them in sequence. Risk increases. And whenever I do crashing, because of the resources coming, the cost increases. So the repercussion of crashing, increasing the cost, repercussion of fast tracking is increasing the risk. Got it? So you have to pay a price for every crashing because you have to add resource and pay the price for that resource. For different activity, the price could be different. Then output will be schedule and schedule baseline. And when, because you have done all the optimization, everything, so you baseline the schedule. And that way, that schedule will serve as a main project schedule to carry out the project. Okay, controlling schedule is nothing more than what we have learned so far. Controlling schedule means doing all these things, identifying new activities if we have left, changing the dependencies if possible, changing the duration of the goal if possible, changing number of resources on the project if possible, doing fast tracking and crashing, whatever possible in optimizing the control, optimizing the schedule in the changed scenario. and that is called controlling the schedule. It has all those activities which we have learned just now, nothing more except that we got the performance data. With respect to performance data, we get work performance information, that is plan versus actual. Plan versus actual, that we can, that we get, and based on that we take measures to do fast tracking, controlling or fast tracking, crashing, resource leveling, other optimization, simulation, all these things we do, modeling, we all these things to see that our project should get delivered within the time. And if we are not possible, then we give the warning much ahead of time. So scheduling control is doing this again and again throughout the project, from as soon as the project schedule, first project schedule is ready till the end of the project, to ensure that project delivers on time. Okay, we will learn about earned value management. This also applies, because earned value management not only give about costing but also talk about schedule. But we will learn into the costing chapter. Right? So this is done, scheduling part is done. Schedule forecast as an output of the schedule control will be done through EVM, and which we learn in earned value management in the cost, project cost management. I'm done with it. If you have any questions, please let me know. We can meet tomorrow morning, and what I request you, if you get time, attempt those 15 questions. Otherwise, when you join tomorrow morning, first thing we will do is attempt the questions of time management. So if you complete this 10, 15, 20 minutes job, then we will save some time during our course. We'll like discuss some other parts. Otherwise, we can do it here also. Right? So thank you very much. See you tomorrow morning. I request you to just join 5 minutes before instead of 5 minutes later. That will really be great. Thank you. See you tomorrow.